Hi, my name is Mike Fuqua. I'm a union family man. I felt it was real important that the truth of what happened and what we're up against is put out there. There's nothing so frustrating as to have a fight come to you. Have a fight come to you, and you know, we put everything we had into this. You know, we weren't we were right there. I mean, we were in the middle of this fight. We didn't have the luxury of coming and going and you know, making a visit and take some pictures and then go home. This was a 24-hour deal, and we put everything we had into it. And so to us, this fight started off it was pretty simple, you know. I took it as somebody was coming into my home and taking away the means I had to feed my children. So it was everything to me, and I was going to do whatever it took to win this fight. And that's what we were doing. We were taking all kinds of actions, and we were working around the clock. And, you know, I come from a small local, and our rank-and-file membership has a lot of, you know, my eight, six or eight uncles were all longshoremen. My father was a longshoreman. My grandfather was a longshoreman. My 20-year-old son just started. And so, you know, this was our life. So we were fighting a fight that we thought was noble and worthwhile. You know, I didn't see the end result coming until it got closer. You know, what a shock it was, because somebody told us in a meeting about turning this fight over to the international to handle for us. What somebody said was, is that you want to, this is your jurisdiction, you take this fight on, and if you need help, you ask them for it, but you don't turn it over to them, because their interest may not be the same interest that you have. Those words came shockingly true by the end of this whole conflict, because while we were turning up the heat and we were going around getting solidarity, I thought that's what you do in a fight. I thought when somebody comes and raids your jurisdiction, that's what you do. You go out and you get help and you get backing. I got here this morning, me and Kyle and some of the fellas here took us around town and showed us some things. We had, took some pictures, had a good time. We went to Local 10, and we were looking at the hall, and when I walked out the door, I stuck him on a question. I asked him what 1549 meant to him, and nobody knew what it was. And I said, well, it's a retired longshoreman from Local 10. His name was Harry Bridges, and he set up a pretty fundamental basis of unionism for us to follow, and it's a pretty solid foundation. You know, I know in the he said that, I don't think the employers will ever beat us. I think maybe greed from within would destroy this union. And I think he wrote again at the end of his time that playing politics can kill this union. And so I think we all see what politics are doing for this country and the working people. It isn't working out too good for us. I don't think playing along in that, playing along the same line with politics for this union is going to work out too good for us either. I think solidarity is what won this union. I think it's the only thing that's gonna keep it. And so here we are fighting a year and a half into this battle with everything we got. We're putting our asses on the line day in and day out to put the heat on these guys. And you know, the other day we had a barbecue for a court date that was going on in Longview. And we got people from around the world coming to our hall, and they sent us a bunch of banners. Different people sent us banners from all over the world. See, I better not talk so loud. So, these banners, it's weird how things work out, isn't it? So it was banners like that one, except for it wasn't misspelled. Longview was spelled correctly. So, you know, we had these people from around the world. We had dock workers from around the world come to show solidarity for this court case that was starting. And you should see the look on their faces when we whipped out these banners that we had, you know, rolled up and put away. And they were like, hey, that's our banner we sent you, you know. And I looked on YouTube during this fight, and here these people are around the world taking action just for our cause, boarding ships, warning captains to send a message back to that corporation that this will not be tolerated. You know, and then I don't know how this works, but, and then I hear that the West Coast isn't even taking actions against the shipping line. That doesn't make sense to me. I fought a noble battle. I put my ass on the line every day. You know, I did things that could have, I probably wouldn't be sitting here today. So anyway, it doesn't make sense to me. And, you know, I'm not too into politics other than the fact that I don't think they're working out very good for us. I wasn't really an activist at all before this fight started. I got to tell you, I was just an average worker that was comfortably numb. And until this fight came to my town, I didn't know too much about it. But with everything I had, I put into this fight. And so this fight, I'm going to continue. And, you know, I'm going to spread the word of solidarity. I'm going to spread the truth. I don't care about people's politics and what they think about what I say. If you don't like it, that's too bad, because I'm just out here and I'm going to speak the truth. And so I know our union officials and our local seem to be put under attack, and I still don't see the reason why. But it kind of all makes sense when you look at the big picture, because we're playing into a system that is not going to work for us. The only system that's ever worked for labor was solidarity, taking action, and making them listen. Everything that this union's ever won was won through a fight. Nothing was ever given to us. We have to take action to preserve what we have. When I see politics being played, I know we're losing. I don't want to try to maintain what we have. I want to move forward. Either you move forward very slowly and consistently, or you're going to fall back very quickly. And so I don't think trying to preserve what we have is going to work. We're just going to lose and lose and lose. So I think we need to take a different direction. And that's the word I'm going to come and spread, is that the ILWU, I don't want to see end up being an empty eggshell of a union like a lot of other unions have become by playing politics. This union was founded, well, we all know the history of the ILWU, what it took to win this thing. You know, in 34, when people died for this union, people of other unions made decisions to back us up. And they did that against their officers' opinion and their advice. You know, within weeks, 300,000 people were on strike with us, and there wasn't a union, I don't think, of any of them that they said, yeah, this is a good idea. But look what came out of it. It's the only thing that's ever worked. It's only it's ever going to work for this working class. So anyway, I'm happy that we had the solidarity come around us, you know, and the actions that were taken. I just want to be, when I go out and speak and the actions I take, I want it to be really what's going on. I don't understand the politics that's played out over and over again. I'm hoping that we can get things turned around from within. I don't know of any other way to do it except for speak the truth. You know, my rank and file was not fighting for the we got. This settlement is not what we were fighting for. I don't think it was what the people were coming to back us up for. I think we could have got a better deal a year before without even raising a finger if this is what we were willing to take. But this isn't what we were willing to take. And so through some pretty sleazy backhanded ways, this thing was pushed through, and now we're stuck left with the repercussions of it. And it's not looking good. I can tell you that. I don't think this fight's even over. I think it's going to come back up because the contract that was put in play is not a manageable contract. It's a one-sided contract. They don't want us there, and they're doing everything they can to push us out. Unfortunately, I think we're in a worse position now than we were before we accepted this contract. I think we had a better idea of what we were fighting for. We had a better chance of getting what we needed then than we do now. But we're going to take this fight on no matter what. You know, we're we're working under some pretty bad conditions in there. It's not not what we're used to. It's not what the ILWU is used to. So I'm happy that I get the opportunity to go out and speak the truth, and I'm not held back by the legal ramifications of speaking for the union. I'm just a rank and file member. This is my opinion. But I can tell you, this is the opinion of 90% of the Local 21. So we're still fighting this day, and it's probably not over. And so I know whenever I go out and I meet people and I see things that are going on, the injustice of the import truckers, some of these other struggles, that is, there could be not a closer alliance with somebody like the import truckers and the injustice that's going on to them that we could possibly have. I don't see why we don't stand for our fellow workers. That's what Harry Bridges said. He said, let's organize. He said, let's stand by our fellow man even before our own master contract. That's what won us this union. It's the only thing that's going to keep this union. So my word is I'm going out and I'm spreading solidarity. I'm looking for people to just do a little research and understand the truth. That's all it takes. You can't sit around and take other people's opinions of what's going on and be blind to what the truth is. I mean, I think most people know that, hey, this contract sucks. You know, but nobody wants to come out and say anything about it. But here I am. So anyway, thanks for having me here, and I'll give it to the professionals here.
Thank you, everybody, for having me. Just really quickly, I wanted to say that in the beginning of Mike's talk, that he said that he was out there, didn't have the luxury of going there and leaving, and this was a battle that they had to participate in, and I think that a lot of these battles have been missed and have been, the workers have been led into exactly that kind of a fight that you said you didn't have the luxury, and I think that you, the workers, need to take the credit that you deserve for having the courage and the strength to do the kind of fight that you took. So I'd like to give it up for them one more time. So, as Steve said, I'm kind of here wearing two hats tonight as a member of a local union here who took a stand. And so I'm going to try and talk about both things and draw some conclusions. First of all, we passed a resolution that was penned by my union brother, who's in the audience tonight, Matt Scott, in support of the ILWU Local 10 for their work stop action on April 4th. And that sort of got the conversation started in our union. And actually, it was spoken against from the stage from our leadership. And the reason being over a beef between the two unions over the historical site that they wanted to build on, which was, I think, the first Longshore Hall. And anyway, most of the membership thought that was a pretty ridiculous reason to not show solidarity. And that resolution called for supporting their shutdown action and demanding that all legal action be stopped against the union. That resolution was passed pretty overwhelmingly by the membership, even though it was spoken against from the stage. The next resolution that came was after things really got fired up in Longview, and it was a resolution to support Local 21 in all of their actions, including occupying the facility, in the actions of blocking the train and et cetera, and demanding that the charges against those members be dropped. That was passed again by the membership with some opposition from our officials. The third resolution came immediately after that, which was to send representatives from our union to reinforce the picket line if called to do so by Local 21. As you know, that call did come out, and our leadership was able to say that because the resolution that we passed said representatives, a representative of the union can only be an elected official or an appointed member by our business manager, and therefore the business manager and the president were the only people who were going to go as representatives to reinforce that picket line. And this actually caused quite a bit of stir amongst the membership because they realized the intention that they voted for, what they wanted, was to send a group of us up there to stand in solidarity in the action that was going to happen when the ship came in. So I brought another resolution which outlined a more concrete plan to send people to Longview after we got a letter on letterhead, which was Dan Kaufman was very busy, but we were able to get him to send this letter explicitly asking that we act on our resolution and send people up there. That resolution was ruled out of order because we would be directing the business manager in his duties as appointing representatives from our union to go up there. So the challenges of having some of your union leadership be an obstacle were all-encompassing in this fight. I think that a lot of us felt there was a comparison between the unions here in San Francisco and the ILWU. There's this talk about how we're in a bubble, like we have these really strong unions and we exist in this bubble. And we saw that the ILWU's bubble was being threatened, that they were trying to union bust and that they were threatening to bust that bubble. And so the comparison was made a lot with the operating engineers coming in to the possibility of somehow subverting legal context in order to build a high rise. They can maybe bring in a lower paid trade and say, well, they're union, right? And then have them do the electrical work in a high rise in San Francisco. And how would we want to react? And what would we want other unions to do if we were to take direct militant action that like happened in Longview? So I think a lot of that played into the decisions of the membership to go ahead and go against some of the advice and direction coming to us from the top. And I think that also there's just sort of a new culture with the economic crisis, and I like to credit a lot of the direct, some of the direct action and some of the stuff coming from Occupy for creating a culture where it's okay to rebel, it's okay to get up and say, no, that's not what we want to do. We don't believe that aligning with our employers somehow against non-union employers and their workers is gonna win any battles for us. We realize that it's us and it's you, and you are the ones on the opposite side of the table, and so we have to work together with all workers to challenge those things. So now on to Occupy Oakland. Because of the participation in from my local union in passing these resolutions and talking about it, when November 2nd happened and the port shutdown happened, I really appreciated the idea of the social movement and the people's sort of natural uprising connecting with these struggles. And so when I heard the call for the coordinated West Coast port shutdown, I really wanted to get involved, and I thought it was a fantastic opportunity to expand on this reciprocal beneficial relationship and also to tie together the connection between the oppression of the port truck drivers who were trying to organize, which is also part of the port shutdown agenda, and the overall state repression that is happens to labor and happens to Occupy. And I understand that it's still happening in Longview to the Longview members. And even with the Occupy movement being a little bit slower right now, it's still happening to a great degree. The FBI is raiding people's houses for planning conferences and these things, and I think it's important to tie those things together. Obviously, we are on one side, and there are people on the other side. So I also wanted to point out just that there was a ton of work that went into organizing around December 12th and around the caravan to Longview. I have a book up here. It's got all kinds of stuff in it. I'd be happy to go over some of the organizing stuff if people are interested in that. And I have tons of resolutions passed by labor unions and Occupy, and realizing that we're all connected and that we're all on the same side. I wanted to quickly point out, I'm really glad that Tova's here tonight, that a lot of the organizing done through the Occupy movement was done by very militant and radical women, and that the labor movement has a poor history of recognizing that work. And I think that it's important that we do that. So I'm glad that Tova played a very instrumental role, and I'm glad that she's here to talk about that role. So I wanted to just also talk that the this beneficial relationship that I talked about was a lot of the stuff that Steve already mentioned regarding the port shutdowns for Oscar Grant, for Mumia, for the Israeli apartheid, the South African apartheid, and all these things. There's a long, rich history of the community recognizing that we need these folks organized and strong at this very critical and pivotal point of commerce. And it's been, the community can also come out and participate and inject itself into these struggles. So this relationship is really important, it's really critical, and it's really strong. And I just lastly wanted to just throw out that I think that we can discuss the wins and the losses and the benefits and those types of things and what's come out of what happened. But in my mind, as long as capitalism exists in this country, there's always going to be these conflicts. These conflicts are always going to happen. We'll win a little bit, we'll lose a little bit, but it's always going to be there. And what's important for me and what I think happened here, and it's really important to look at that going forward, is that we were able to escalate tactics, support workers who were willing to escalate those tactics. We enhanced the conflict to the point that every actor on the other side of the table, the governor, the Coast Guard, which means the president, a huge corporation, everybody on the other side of the line was working together to try and smash and make sure that this conflict in Longview didn't happen. And unfortunately, they were successful in that, but it shows that the December 12th shutdowns and a lot of the movement building up to it, and they wouldn't have done that if they didn't believe that we could do it. They would not have gone to that table and gone to those extremes and gone to that length if they didn't know. If they didn't know that we could successfully, seriously threaten their rule. And so I just wanted to say that now is a good time to, things are settled a little here, settled a little there. These forums are important. It's also really important that we build organizing capacity for the next time, because these things are going to keep happening. That means that within your unions, within your working places, whatever they are, we need to build groupings of people who are willing to fight back. And we need to connect those groupings of people through whatever means we have, if it's Occupy Oakland Labor Solidarity, or if it's whatever it is, we need to connect those things so that the next time there's a struggle, the next time there's a social uprising, the next time there's a wave, we can really push and fan the flames of that wave. And I would encourage everybody to take those steps going forward. I think that's all I have. Thanks.
Looking at what some people perceive as the only result of the heroic struggle against EGT in Longview, the concessionary contract unfortunately results in using it as a basis to critique the entire struggle. Unfortunately, this obscures some great lessons we can take from the struggle and how we can use labor community alliances to build a movement based on solidarity and class consciousness among the workers and oppressed. So I'd like to walk you back through some of the events in this struggle from my perspective as an Occupy Oakland organizer. On the heels of the brutal attack on the Oakland camp by the OPD and the state, in the short week of organizing for the general strike, the ILWU rank and file members issued a statement titled, "Defend Occupy Oakland with the Muscle of Organized Labor," urging support for the general strike. The Occupy Oakland Strike Assembly, in turn, issued a statement which said in part, "We will march on the port of Oakland and shut it down. We are doing this in order to blockade the flow of capital, as well as show solidarity with the ILWU workers in their struggle against EGT in Longview, Washington." This was the first of many subsequent actions paving the way for true solidarity between workers and the community, which combined demonstrated a new power not seen in the U.S. for decades. And, you know, even just being able to talk about blockading the flow of capital, when was the last time that was done, you know, in a popularized way, you know? Other unions supported the general strike as well, including SEIU 1021, who publicly called on their members to join, quote, a day-long peaceful day of action in support of Occupy Oakland and against the banking industry and last week's police brutality against the Occupy Oakland encampment, unquote. The Carpenters Union, Local 713, issued a similar statement. Teamsters brought a truckload of water for the marchers, and the Oakland Education Association supplied porta potties. The California Nurses Association, UAW Local 2865, and the Inland Boatmen's Union also supported the strike. The Port of Oakland was successfully shut down on the afternoon shift of November 2nd by a powerful throng of up to 50,000 people. And with the solidarity of the ILWU Local 10, with some major disruptions on the day shift as well, significantly taking the struggle to the point of production, shutting down Wall Street on the waterfront. The messages of solidarity with the ILWU Local 21 were heard loud and clear in the speeches and press releases of the day. Dan Kaufman, president of Local 21, was able to come down to Oakland for a November 19th Occupy Oakland Labor March and rally, where he personally thanked Occupy for our solidarity and support. Soon after the strike, OO answered Occupy LA's call for a West Coast port shutdown on December 12th, with Occupy Oakland taking on the leadership for organizing. We developed 3 points of unity for the coastwide shutdown. They were solidarity with the UAW Local 21 in Longview in their fight against EGT's union busting, solidarity with the port truckers in LA who were fighting SSA, an anti-union port terminal operator, majority owned by Goldman Sachs, and as an Occupy strike back against the brutal nationally coordinated attacks on the Occupy movement, and they were nationally coordinated, organized by the 1% and their government agents. The Port of Oakland, representing the Wall Street West boardrooms, launched an attack against Occupy, buying full-page ads in the San Francisco Chronicle, Oakland Tribune, and the New York Times. McElrath, afraid of the power of his own ranks, issued a statement warning Occupy to stay out of the union's affairs. Despite the barrage of attacks, labor solidarity among the ranks of the ILWU, other unions, and Occupy prevailed. D12 resulted in the shutdowns and disruptions up and down the coast and inland as well, from Vancouver, Canada, to San Diego, and even Houston, with Oakland leading the way, bringing out 20,000 people. All three shifts were shut down in Oakland, with Portland, Longview, and Seattle shutting down at least one shift, as well as bringing the struggle to the point of production once more. Occupy Seattle described their involvement with the D12 shutdown. Quote, many of us are the 89% of US workers who are not in unions, who are unemployed, students, and houseless. Our picket lines might not have the same legal standing as official union picket lines, but when the unions first started picketing back in the day, they were also considered illegitimate. D12 is the first of many actions that Occupy will take as a new wing of the labor movement, unquote. Now organizing for the caravan to Longview to stop the scab ship from being loaded into full gear, Occupy used the coastal network it had built for the D12 shutdown and working closely with the committee to defend the ILWU and rank and file members of other unions. Building for the caravan became complex as the ILWU international leadership showed its fear of unleashing the power of the developing joint community action. International President McElrath clamped down on Local 21 President Kaufman and the locals' ranks with a gag order, isolating the local from its entire support network. Ultimately, EGT was forced to agree to recognize the ILWU jurisdiction in a last-minute deal, brokered by the Washington governor in fear of the impending battle in the small town of Longview, where it was clear that the forces of Occupy and the ILWU and other union ranks were ready to fight to stop the ship from being loaded, despite threats of the U.S. Coast Guard and local and regional repressive forces preparing to escort the ship into harbor. Make no mistake, the contract itself is not a victory, and President McElrath, who brokered the concessionary deal, hogtied the struggle with his gag orders to Local 21 in an attempt to isolate the embattled local from its strongest supporters. McElrath had dug himself in with collaborative ideology, buying into the idea that the workers' jobs only exist if the company is prosperous, tying the union's fate together with that of the capitalists. The treachery of International President McElrath with his forced isolation of Local 21 allowed a highly concessionary contract to be rammed down the locals' collective throat. The struggle still demonstrated the power which combined worker and community alliances can wield. this is what we have to take out of this. We need to learn how to use this to our advantage going forward. This struggle has allowed labor to see the possibilities and the absolute necessity of newly forged labor community alliances.
I want to give some historic ILWU context to this discussion. I began working on the waterfront in 1953, so I think I'm in a small way qualified. Longview is the first time that a contract was imposed by the international officers on a longshore local that really abandons the hiring hall. The hiring hall was a main demand in 1934. It was won against tremendous odds. It was a one issue on which longshoremen were quite clearly, in 1934, not prepared to compromise. And the ILWU continued to defend the hiring hall until Longview. There's a myth quite commonly held that there's a seamless relationship between the leadership of the ILWU and its membership. Nothing could be further from the truth. There is a history of betrayals and capitulation to the employers and the government by international officers, betrayals mainly of non-West Coast longshoremen and non-longshore locals who were on strike. Going back to 1974, the Canadian longshoremen were on strike. The shipping companies diverted their ships with Canadian cargoes to the Northwest U.S. ports who worked the cargo. The ILWU international officers told Canadian longshoremen not to send pickets to the U.S. ports. In the 1974 ILWU International Convention in Vancouver, British Columbia, six members of the Longshore Warehouse Militant Caucus, of which I belong, appeared in the hotel lobby just outside the meeting room where the international conference was taking place with leaflets and banners denouncing this betrayal of Canadian longshoremen. Harry Bridges tried to get us physically thrown out of the hotel, but he wasn't successful. I'm not sure that what would happen today. In 1970, the Trona ILWU local was engaged in a 115-day strike against a borax mine and processing plant way out in the Mojave Desert. I bet nobody here has ever been to Trona. Actually, I've only met two people who've been to Trona. It's by reputation, it's supposed to be the most unlivable city in the country. The Trona workers picketed a ship in the harbor of Los Angeles, which was loading the scam-produced products. The ship was not worked. ILWU longshoremen did not cross the picket line. The area contract arbitrator, Rollins, ruled that this was a legitimate picket line under the terms of the contract. Then an injunction against picketing was issued. At that point, the international officials ordered the Trona local not to picket ships loading scam cargo. Ships continued to be loaded, and the strike was lost. The Trona local had to accept a very inferior contract and to capitulate in 12 ILWU members being fired. In 1974, the Boron ILWU local, way out of the Mojave Desert, was forced into a long, bitter strike. Los Angeles, ILWU longshoremen, continued to load scab borax products all during the strike. Boron workers were told by the international officers not to picket the ships. The strike was lost and 400 ILWU members were replaced by scabs. Again, in the recent Boron strike, Los Angeles longshoremen loaded scab products. And again, Local 30 was Boron workers were ordered by the international officers not to picket the ships, and a grossly inferior contract was imposed on the local. The question has been raised sharply. Was Longview destined to fail? I think not. The longshoremen won against great odds in the past, as he did in 1934. They won also against great odds in 1948. The ILWU in 1948 was forced into a 3.5-month strike just to save the union. The U.S. government, the waterfront employers, the AFL, and the CIO all ganged up to destroy the ILWU in 1948. The longshoremen remained firm, They stopped the scabbing at Fort Mason here in San Francisco, and they came out with the union and the contract, coastwise contract intact. That was a strike that, if you looked at it objectively, they should not have won. I'll get to that later. What would have happened in Longview when the ship arrived to load the scab grain if this sellout contract had not been imposed? In thinking about this, I think what would probably have happened is a major confrontation would have ensued between the police and thousands of Northwest longshoremen and trade unionists reinforced by Occupy supporters. It would have probably been a major confrontation with many arrests, brutality, and so forth. The ship would likely have been loaded, but it's also likely that West Coast longshoremen would have voluntarily walked off the job in spite of what the international officers wanted them to do, presenting a de facto West Coast strike. If that had happened, it is very likely that the East Coast and Gulf ILA longshoremen would have struck, causing the first nationwide longshore strike. Given the dependence of the U.S. economy on ocean shipping, a victory in Longview would have been within the realm of possibility if this had happened. There is no great puzzle why the ILWU bureaucracy and their hangers-on and the locals shrank from a real struggle. The ILWU officers are committed to labor peace. They are business unionists who see themselves as having a common interest with the bosses to restrain the impulses of the rank-and-file workers to fight to defend their gains. Theirs is the ideology of class collaboration, an ideology which is reinforced by the draconian penalties contained within the 1947 Taft-Hartley slave labor law, which outlaws all of the measures needed to win strikes. I want to conclude my remarks with a line from a Woody Guthrie song in which he was giving some advice to people who are engaged in defending the working class. And it goes like this. If you play the game, they'll call you a gambler. But if you don't gamble, you never will win. That's it.
First of all, I just want to say that there's been some excellent presentations. I wanted to focus in particularly on the remarks of Sister Tova, because I thought that she was so critical in terms of chronicling our struggle. And for those who would like to get a more detailed analysis as to what happened, there is a booklet called United, ILWU Ranks and Occupy Fight Wall Street on the Waterfront. This is a compilation of articles that were written by people like Tova, David Welsh, Judy Greenspan, and others. And I think that one of the things that it does is to provide a narrative as to how this struggle evolved. And I also wanted to say with respect to Brother Mike, he is so important to this struggle because of the fact that he has a lot of courage. There's been a tremendous amount of pressure put on Local 21 by that entity right across the street, the International. I'm a third generation longshoreman. I'm speaking today not for Local 10, I'm speaking for myself. I've been in this union for over 25 years. Grandfather was a part of this union. He was blacklisted during the 1940s. Father came into the industry in the 1960s. It is so important for the foundations of our union, which provide for autonomy of locals, rank and file leadership, not top down, that we are experiencing right now. I also want to acknowledge the points that were made by Brother, did you say it was Keylor? Okay, all right. Providing some historical context for this, you know, for the ILWU, because You know, we have a lot of what some people would call ILWU groupies. They are so infatuated with our history, and rightfully so. But they don't realize how difficult it is when you're talking about shutting down the fifth busiest port in the United States of America. This is no mean, this is not something that's easy to do. Because you're dealing with various sectors and segments of thought. All of our members are not on the left. Let's get that straight. One of my mentors says that there's very little left in the ILWU. That's not an overstatement. That's why these kinds of gatherings are so important, so that young people will have an opportunity to really learn what this union is all about. One of the things that I want to talk about tonight is lessons learned from this EGT struggle. And there were many, many lessons learned, and many of them have been discussed tonight. But one of the most fundamental lessons for me is that the tactics and strategies that were employed in 1934, when we went up against what Studs Terkel call the shock troops of capitalism, the shipping companies. What we learned then is that when the rank and file takes action to cause economic hardship on the bosses, that's the only leverage that we have. And it was demonstrated again during the EGT struggle. And it started with the brothers and sisters in Longview. Let me just remind the people in this room what they encountered. They were not only arrested, they were brutalized, pepper sprayed, arms broken, had their homes raided, they were under surveillance by the state. Yes. But make no mistake about it, EGT had no idea what was coming. But we must ask ourselves a very fundamental question. Why would EGT think that it could take on one of the most world-renowned, militant, democratic, rank-and-file unions and win? We're all leftists in this room. Let's be very sober now and think. Why would they believe that they could do it and get away with it? Well, I got some answers. Maybe many of you might have thought about it too. First thing is, these people got think tanks. They know what you're made of. They know what kind of locals you come from. They know whether or not you are part of the Harry Bridges legacy of bottom-up, rank-and-file, left analysis, working class, progressive, confronting the bosses and capital. They know whether or not that's in your makeup. And I would submit to you that the leadership that we have right now, that ain't in their makeup. Howard referred to it as business unionist. He's being polite. But the fact remains that that contract was a sellout. I didn't even realize how bad it was. The more you read, the worse it got. But I was very determined from the beginning not to allow that sellout agreement in any way undermine the wonderful strategies and tactics that we employed in this struggle. To begin with, let's just make one thing clear. The Port of Oakland not only is the fifth busiest container port in the United States, it's one of three principal Pacific Coast gateways for the United States containerized cargo, along with San Pedro Bay in Southern California and the Puget Sound in the Pacific Northwest. The majority of the port's trade is with Asia. The port is critical in meeting expected U.S. demands for imports from Asia and U.S. exports throughout the world. One of the great natural harbors of the world, the Port of Oakland sits on the western terminus of Union Pacific Railroad, Transcontinental Central Corridor, Rail Route, and it connects to the Burlington Northern Santa Fe Transcontinental Route. There's more. These two routes provide efficient rail transportation to the Midwest, linking the rest of the country with key trans-Pacific trade routes across Asia and the globe. Virtually every state in the U.S. relies on the Port of Oakland for importing or exporting products. I got a question for you. It's a rhetorical question, but I'm going to give you an answer. Why is it today that when we talk about the Occupy movement, it is not associated with shutting down international commerce? That's a very, very important point and lesson that we need to understand. When we're talking about fighting Wall Street, that's one of the most direct connections with Wall Street. It's what they call intermodal good movement. Ships, trucks, rails. When I was being asked on November 2nd and December 12th, how did I feel about truckers having to lose a day's pay? My response is, why don't you go to Walmart and ask them how much money they lost today? Go to the retailers who depend on just-in-time delivery. Howard made reference to the fact of what could possibly have unfolded had we gone to Longview. I was ready to go. I'm 65 years of age, and I really didn't want to take no ass whippings, but I had to go because young rank and filers of Local 10 were asking me, Brother Clarence, are you going to get on the bus? Yes, I'm going to get on the bus. Because I've been telling them throughout my years on this waterfront that their day is coming. This is the reason why we enjoy all of the benefits of being longshore workers. It's because we have our union who has been on the left. We have been radical and unafraid of it. It was for that reason that I was motivated to put out Written As It Happened. When I went to the ILWU convention and caucus, I put out this piece, spent my own money, with quotes from Harry Bridges, from various caucuses and conventions going from 1949 to 1953, where he said, we're left and we're proud of it. The power of this local, the power of this union, does not lie with that leadership. It does not lie with fair weathered politicians. I'm insulted that a union like the ILWU would say that Governor Gregor gets all the credit. That's insulting. That's blasphemy. That woman did not, let me tell you what that woman did. She met with EGT and ILWU leadership a dozen times. This came from her own spokesperson who mentioned it. So what magic did she produce in the 13th meeting? Well, we know what magic was produced. It was the ILWU. It was Occupy, it was people of color, it was anti-police brutality organizations such as the Oscar Grant movement, it was social justice activists, it was unemployed workers, it was students, lesbian, gay, transgender. Yes, the whole gamut. And if you were in downtown Oakland on November 2nd and you witnessed that beautiful banner that ran across 14th Street, death to capitalism. I had to pinch myself to see if I was really, is this really happening? Yes. That coalition on that day did something very remarkable. We outflanked not only Big Bob and his regime, but all of the labor tops
We outflanked them. We outflanked the Democratic Party. Right. Yes, we did.
And we need to.
That is correct. This was a working class action. As many historical actions that I have been a part with, as far as the ILWU is concerned, I have never been a part of anything like what we witnessed on November 2nd. That was historical. And it wasn't just protest. It was an act of resistance. It was an act of confrontation to capital. That's what this struggle is all about. That's what the lesson that we want to learn from this action. Do you realize the kind of turmoil that could have taken place if those of us in the ILWU would have cowered down to Big Bob, telling us that we, telling the people that they can't come down to the ports. He don't own that port, he just works there. The taxpayers own that port, and we showed that. And just for a matter of clarification, Port of Oakland on November 2nd was shut down for two shifts, but there was major disruption on the day shift. It's also important to understand that on December the 12th, it was shut down for 24 hours. The Port of Portland was shut down. I don't believe they worked all day and all night. Seattle was shut down on the second and third shift, overtime shift. Did you guys work at all in Longview? Longview was shut down for 24 hours. Bellingham, Washington was disrupted. Port Hueneme was disrupted. And if we would have had more courageous leadership from Local 13, we could have did much more damage in Los Angeles. But that's coming. This is something that I'm sure the people at the White House, the State Department, all very concerned about what happened. Let me just take you down memory lane a little bit. Because it was mentioned that we had taken that courageous action on Father's Day, I think that was in 2010, protesting the killing of the workers, the people who were volunteering to take supplies to Gaza, if you remember that. That caused so much of a stir that the Israeli consulate paid a visit to the Port of Oakland and to our president, wanting to show the error of our ways, wanted to meet with the executive board. We refuse. We don't meet with people representing the foreign countries. But the reason why I'm mentioning this, and it's important for me to do so, is because these actions that we take are not symbolic. They are very, very real. Very real indeed. And what we need to be able to learn from this is that, like, we need to understand this. That contract that was negotiated was not the typical way that contracts are negotiated in the ILWU. The rank and filers didn't even have a chance to read it. That's an insult. So what we've got to do, we've got some tremendous housekeeping to do within the ILWU. But let me just conclude with this. Where do we go from here? Some people think Occupy is dead. That's not true. Occupy actually started before New York. It actually started in Wisconsin. Let's not forget that. That is what captured the attention of the world. Occupy, you took control over the state capital. That's the lesson that we need to understand. It doesn't have to be an encampment. I don't like camping, some of you may, but I'm not a camper. But I remind you of something that was written about Bridges in the November 5th, 2011 issue of the San Francisco Chronicle, when they did a piece on a statue that's going to be erected. They said, Harry Bridges, honoring the original occupier. Yeah. But one thing is for certain. I want everybody to understand this. I give a lot of credit and support to Occupy for creating the discussion around capitalism and being critical of it, because now people understand what the nature of the problem. It's not because of the fact that this is just a tough period right now. No, it's not. This is a crisis of capitalism. Capitalism has run out of time. It can no longer provide the things that it once did for us. And we need to confront that.
The title of this forum is Lessons from the ILWU Battle Against EGT and Longview and the Struggle Ahead. So the importance of this is that the EGT battle may be over, but a year ago, the Northwest Grain Handlers Association that handles all the grain in the Northwest said to the union, we're going to have only a one-year contract this year. That means that contract is coming up now. And the reason they did that is to see what's going to happen with the EGT contract. Because if it was a victory for EGT in terms of a major concessionary contract, which I think most of us agree that it is, then the grain handlers are going to go for that. And this is a major, major move by the world capitalists, because the grain from the Northwest and Canada, by and large, come out through the Columbia River. And so if they are able to shackle the ILWU with a major concessionary contract like EGT, just to give you an idea how bad it is, they have a section in the contract, and you should go to the transportworkers.org website and read the contract yourself. It's only 15 pages. But they have a section called No Interruption of Work. For instance, when we have stop work meetings, they can bring in scabs and have scabs and management do our work. The same thing with health and safety. This is a dangerous injury industry. We have lots of injuries. If we stand by on health and safety, which happens frequently, they can bring in scabs and management to do our work. They said, you can have the right to have picket line language, but and we have strong language in our PCLCD, our coastwide contract. But if you honor the picket line, we're going to have scabs and management do your work behind the picket line. This is the kind of language that's in this contract. And what really rubbed us the wrong way, a lot of our members, was every year on July 5th, we shut down every port on the West Coast to honor the martyrs of the 1934 maritime strike and the general strike here in San Francisco. All the ports on the West Coast are shut down. Well, this year, there was a ship at EGT, and there was a ship next door at Peavey, which is the second worst contract on the coast. But even at Peavey, they called the union and said, we're not going to work the ship today. But at EGT, management and scabs did our work on the docks. But that's not the worst of it. The worst of it is that the international president, McElrath, called the local and tried to get the local president to get his men and women to go to work at EGT. And he said, Dan Kaufman said, no, my members are taking a rest today. What he meant was they're going to honor the fallen, just like every other port on the West Coast. So this EGT contract was a debacle. It was really very bad. And what's coming up next year is the 2014 is the master contract for all the cargo on the West Coast. So you see where this is going. It starts off with one terminal in one port and spreads like a cancer. It's important to learn the lessons from this because, quite honestly, for the last couple decades, there is a class war in America. It's been going on since capitalism has been here. But the truth of the matter is we've been losing. Workers have been losing. And why have we been losing? We've been losing because we play by the boss's rules. We adhere to the capitalist laws. And because of that, we don't see real class struggle in America. We saw an inkling of it at Longview very few times in the last few decades. There are business unionists that run the union. That's the problem. The leadership in the trade union movement today is not a class struggle leadership. It's business union leadership. And if you compare that to when we had real class struggle in this country, you see that we had general strikes in Minneapolis, in San Francisco, in the 30s, in Toledo, Ohio. We had sit-ins in the Midwest, in the auto factories. It challenged the basis of capitalism, private property. We don't see that today. And probably most critically is we don't have a political alternative. I think the thing that may be most powerful in terms of keeping the working class struggle back in this country is the fact that so many of the union's leadership is bound to the Democratic Party. And every time election comes around, it's the same old thing. You got to hold your nose and vote for the Democrats. But the fact of the matter is, we in the ILWU and other unions attempted about 15 years ago to get a Labor Party going. We sent delegates to that convention in Cleveland, Ohio in 1995. That Labor Party was really more of a pressure on the Democratic Party. It really wasn't an attempt to build an independent working class party in this country that's going to challenge capital. So I think another thing that holds back class struggle in this country is the left. I mean, Clarence said it before, there's very little left of the left in Local 10, but to be honest, there's very little left of the left in this country. And it's a shame, it's a scandal that some of the left groups actually supported the ILWU bureaucracy in this struggle. And it was clear very early on that Mikel Rast and his bureaucracy were going to hold back this struggle. And so I blame the reformist left in particular, that gave a pass to Mikel Rast, to Sundat, the Coast Committeeman, and the top leadership of the ILWU, when they should have been criticizing them. There was a piece in the July 25th issue of Counterpunch, and I encourage everybody to read that, because this is what I'm talking about. The reformist left, which is knowledgeable about the trade union movement, covers for a bureaucracy that they know is betraying the rank and file. And they say it in a very slick way. And I want you to also, if you have a chance, read the book by Cal Winslow. He was the author of the article in Counterpunch, Rebel Rank and File. And he writes very eloquently about how the rank and file stood up to the bureaucracy in the 60s and the 70s, how there was real class struggle, not only in the United States, but in Europe, in France, Italy, and England, a strong shop stewards movement. It was from the bottom up. Against the bureaucracy, he writes. There was almost a revolution in France in the 68 worker and student strike. It could have been a revolution. And so he writes very eloquently about the rank and file rising up against the trade union bureaucracy. And then 2 years later, because this book was published in 2010, 2 years later, he takes the position that what the Mikel Rast leadership was doing was the right thing, and that the EGT contract was a victory. A victory. After having the opportunity to read what the contract is and speak to rank and file longshoremen in Longview, I don't know, Mike, did he go up to Longview to see what was going on up there?
I never saw him.
I don't know. It's Cal Winslow in the audience because we offered him speaking time if he's here. Anyway, I myself have written pieces in Counterpunch, and I'm querying them now. I want to respond to this, and I think I got a nice title for this because he and so many of the reformist groups give a pass to business unionists and their betrayal of the trade union bureaucracy. I want to title it Passing Wind Slow, An Analysis of Brain Farts. Because there was a real lapse in his thinking here, or it was a conscious betrayal of the working class movement. He uses three main arguments. One is, he says, well, the ILWU is a bureaucracy, excuse me, it's a democracy. It's not a bureaucracy, it's a democracy, he says. And, you know, there are facts that are very public that he could easily look up. The elections in the ILWU happen every 3 years. In 2006, we had 45,000 members. 7,564 of them voted for Bob McElrath. He was running unopposed. Nobody else ran against him. He got 16.8% of the membership. That's who represents the ILWU. In 3 years later, 2009, we lost about 5,000 members. So 40,000 members, 6,660 voted for the same candidate running unopposed. He did a little bit less. He got 16.7%. And this is what Winslow says. He has the democratic authority of the rank and file. I might point out also that there were two resolutions talking about union democracy at our convention. One was to give the brothers from 21, Local 21, the opportunity to plead not guilty, like the head of the Cowlitz County AFL-CIO, who said, he was the first one arrested, right, Mike? I think he was. Blocking a train, and he was arrested on September 8th, and he said, I'm not pleading guilty, that labor has a right to protest, and we're not guilty of that. So, why shouldn't our rank and file brothers who are out there, they were the ones, the real soldiers out there every day, why shouldn't they be able to plead not guilty? Well, in a democratic union, I think that would make sense, right? Well, the union officials want to do what the lawyers want to do. That's another example of an undemocratic union. It's being not run from the bottom up, but from the top down, particularly by the lawyers. And they just want to get this thing over with, and they're forcing Local 21 members to plead guilty. Another resolution came from Local 10. We just simply said that all contracts need to be voted on by the rank and file. That's what it says in the ILWU Constitution. And that resolution didn't even make it out of the committee, a resolution committee. It was stopped by the bureaucrats. So there's no bureaucracy in the ILWU? You know, it's time to wake up. What really pissed me off was Winslow's second argument is that Occupy Oakland relied on a handful of contacts in the union who had no following. So let me tell you, we issued a leaflet, a rank and file leaflet, danger, ILWU headed in the wrong direction. And I have copies of this if those of you up there that want to read it. The first signer of the petition was Anthony LaVage, who every time he's wanted to run, he's been on the executive board. Anthony is the maker of the motion to shut down every port in the Bay Area in solidarity with the Wisconsin workers. Okay? Another signer was Richard Washington. Richard's here today. Richard, just hold your hand up so people see. Richard went up to Longview. He went up to Longview to show solidarity. That's in the best tradition of the ILWU. And he saw for himself the kind of class struggle that was taking place. And he came back and he spoke passionately to our membership and to the executive board and won broad support in Local 10 for the struggle in Longview. And by the way, from the beginning, talk about union democracy, The international has tried to stop these brothers from Longview from coming down to Local 10 and to other locals, and they've tried to stop us from going up there. That is not union democracy. The other signers were Howard Keylor and Leo Robinson. These brothers were the two people named in the lawsuit in the 1984 anti-apartheid action taken by the union. They were organizers of that action. They were elected to executive board and caucuses many, many times. No following? Where does Winslow get his information from? Herb Mills. Herb Mills was a business agent in Local 10 in 1978 when a ship came in from Chile to bring load bombs for the Pinochet dictatorship. He organized the longshoremen to refuse to handle the bombs going to Chile to kill the flower of the South American proletariat in Chile. They were the most militant, class-conscious section of the working class. And we solidarized with them because the Pinochet government was spilling the blood of workers in the streets in Chile. Herb Mills is elected every time to office in the ILWU. Executive board, business agent, secretary, treasurer, caucus and convention delegate. Larry Wright, same thing. He and myself... We have been elected to the executive board many times. I take pride in being the one who made the motion to shut down all the ports on the West Coast to demand freedom from Mumia Abu-Jamal in 1999. That resolution passed. And then again, the other source of pride is in 2008, I coopered the resolution to shut down all the ports on the West Coast to oppose the imperialist wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. And that passed at the caucus, despite the fact that I was elected to the caucus and the union bureaucracy maneuvered to keep me out of the caucus, but it passed because it resonated within the ranks. There is a following. They may not all be leftists. In fact, some of the people who spoke in favor of the resolution were fairly conservative, but they'd been to Vietnam. They knew what an imperialist war was, and they didn't want the troops in Iraq and Afghanistan to go through what they went through. And so he said, you know, an end to the war, that the labor has the power to end the wars. So I say to Cal Winslow, no following? Where the hell do you get your research from? He did no scholarship when it came to researching this. I'll tell you where he got his information. He got his information from Craig Merrilies. Now, if you don't know who Craig Merrilies is, he's the director of communications for the ILWU. Hey, we all got histories. Here's Craig Merrilies' history. In 1999, AFSCME represents the workers at UC Berkeley, or it did then, and they were talking about wildcatting, and they were mobilizing their ranks for a wildcat action. President Gerald McEntee of AFSCME sent Craig Merrilies, put the local in trusteeship. Merrilies ruled it with an iron fist. And he's quoted as saying, "This is not a democracy. I am the director and I will decide what is needed and what is not for this local." He's the new director of communications because the one he replaced criticized Secretary Treasurer Willie Adams for going to Israel to support the Zionist government there, and he dared, the director of communications, the editor of the Dispatcher, dared to criticize Willie Adams for making that trip, and he was fired. So Merrilies replaced him, top-down, business unionist. That's his background. So The third reason that was given in the Winslow article for supporting the bureaucracy was that Occupy Oakland relied on, the third reason was he attacked Occupy. He said they had the crudest analysis on trade union, on the trade unions. And he in particular said that basically this was a scurrilous attack on McElrath and the bureaucracy. That's not a union bureaucracy. And by the way, they had a very specious argument about what Taft-Hartley represents. Well, I think that Occupy did a pretty damn good job when it came to opposing bourgeois laws. They understood what Taft-Hartley was very clearly. Well, we don't need applause. I just want to get through with this analysis, and so we can have, I'm looking forward to some discussion here. That's what we need, some real discussion on the left. And so, look, the proof is in the pudding. Look what Occupy did around American licorice. Here's Mexican-American workers that work a very difficult job, very low paid, and their union officials are telling them, you can't block the entrance here where the trucks are. We got to let them come in and out. It's illegal. If you do that, we're going to get sued. It'll be in violation of Taft-Hartley. And Occupy Oakland mobilized people at 5 o'clock in the morning to get down there to show them, this is what you got to do to win a strike. You break the laws to win. And they went over, they blocked the gates, the trucks couldn't get in, and then all of a sudden the workers looked over and they said, that's working. I think we'll join you. Well, it's not a fairy tale. It's really what happened. And the problem is that the company all of a sudden came to the bargaining table. The union officials agreed to a concessionary contract, no surprise there. And the workers were frightened into accepting a concessionary contract. This is happening over and over and over again. And it's got to stop. I think Occupy did make some mistakes, and in a comradely way, I think, you know, we need to have criticism. And I think it flows from they don't understand the nature of trade unions. Trade unions are not capitalist institutions. The bureaucracy is pro-capitalist. The bureaucracy is for the Democratic Party. The bureaucracy bends over backwards to obey capitalist anti-labor laws. But the institution itself is not. And we need the militant people in Occupy to get into the unions and organize within the unions. It was, in old school, we called it boring from within. But that's what you need. You need to have a class consciousness and a boldness to go up against the capitalist laws. So what Occupy, I think, did wrong is there were a couple incidents that I've heard of in Seattle and Portland where port truckers who were attempting to get their rigs into or out of the port were personally jostled by some of the Occupy people. And the organizing committee for the action shutting down the port had agreed that they weren't going to stop the port truckers. I think we may have had a couple incidents in the port here in Oakland. But things like this happen when you're just getting off the ground and organizing. People have already spoken to the militancy of the rank and file in Longview, and so I don't need to go over that. But I do want to say, one, in a balanced view of McElrath, he did get arrested, but the circumstances of his arrest have to be understood very clearly. On September 8th, there were 700 or 800 longshoremen blocking a train, and McElrath was all the way in the back. And the brothers and sisters blocking the train said, hey, come on up to the front here. You're the leader. You need to be leading. And so he comes up to the front and he says, well, what do we do now? And they said, well, listen, the cops are going to come over and they see that you're the president and they're going to arrest you. But we got 700-800 members out here. We're gonna circle the cops and the demand they release you. And that's exactly what happened. Exactly what happened. But he got arrested, he was released, and later on they brought charges against him. So in all fairness, he was the president of the union. He was arrested for doing what he should have been doing. And I'll tell you, probably a lot of union officials wouldn't have gone out there to get arrested. But he did do that. He's coming up on trial in September, and he should be defended. He should be defended. But he's not a militant rank-and-file leader that he tries to portray himself as. McElrath now is fond of people calling him the general. The general, yeah. That the general means he's the one honcho on top. The rest of you all are soldiers, and soldiers keep their mouths shut and take orders. So he's the general now. At least that's what he likes to think of himself as. And that's not the way this union was built. The people that fought the militia and fought the police in 1934, in which some people died, never called themselves generals. They were union organizers. One thing that can be said about the union bureaucracy in the ILWU is none of them, not one of them, ever organized an action from the bottom up. They never organized job actions or strikes. I mean, Clarence was with me in 2002 when we were locked out here in the Bay Area and up and down the whole West Coast. And we were the ones that organized mass rallies and marches in the port and in San Francisco. Thousands of trade unionists joined with us. And we went up to the president of the union at the time, Spinoza, and we said, we've got to spread this internationally. And they had no clue what we're talking about. You know, if capital is international, then labor has to be international as well. That's the nature of class struggle. It's international now. So let me conclude by saying that not only is McElrath not a general, he actually betrayed the struggle. Because when he met with Governor Gregoire in Washington with EGT, that's where the deal was cut to end the picketing and to resolve the situation with a concessionary contract. And the reason was quite clear. The Coast Guard was coming with armed vessels to escort the scab ship into Longview. And we protested here in the Bay Area with this sign here, Obama, no government, union busting. The Coast Guard out of Longview. And there was also similar demonstrations in New York City. But McElrath capitulated, even though Local 10 had motions to have caravans, Clarence spoke to it, and Occupy had organized with us to have caravans going up to Longview. There were going to be caravans coming in from Portland and Seattle. There would have been thousands of people there in solidarity with the ILWU. And I talked to the brothers from Local 21 before, and they said, we could have won this battle if we made a stand. Maybe the ship wouldn't have been stopped, but every port on the West Coast would have been shut down, and that's how you beat the capitalists. It's got to be, and not only a West Coast strike, but it could have spread internationally. We are members of the International Dock Workers Council that has affiliates all over the world. They're the militant dock workers that refused to load a ship or work a ship that was loaded by scabs in Charleston, South Carolina. They're proven a militant international working class force. So, you know, in conclusion, I've got to say that there needs to be a change. Though I think the lesson learned here is that we need a class struggle leadership in the trade unions. That the way to do that is organize within the trade unions on caucuses and class struggle programs. I think that Occupy workers need to get involved in these unions and with the militants in the unions form class struggle leaderships or class struggle caucuses that will vie for leadership, fight for leadership to lead these kind of struggles that happen in Longview so that there won't be any more defeats but only victories.
I'm not much of a speaker. Mike asked me to come be his bodyguard on the trip, so. But I was the secretary treasurer of the Cowlitz-Wahkiahkum Labor Council throughout the whole ordeal for the last 5 years, and now I'm the president of the council. And there's a couple things that I've had on my mind, and I don't speak publicly, I hate it. Hold the mic up, all right. Yeah. And there's a lot of things that I, you know, about this struggle and about EGT and the contract that I just don't want to talk about publicly. I think that a lot of the things we should handle internally, you know, we touched on it, we need to clean some house and take care of a lot of issues we have and hopefully improve our union at the same time. But the main thing is the Occupy movement. I want to publicly thank Occupy. I've worked... I've been a part of Occupy Longview since the beginning, and I've watched it, watched everything grow, and December 12th happened, and everything, we couldn't thank them more. You know, we couldn't thank all of you people. Everybody that put time into it, is one of the best feelings ever to see, you know, all the signs and all the support we had. And, basically, Jack, I think, talked about it too. I always preach, you know, think outside the box. We got to find new ways to fight the corporations and the capitalists, and because the old ways, they're not working very well. And I always live my life and, you know, help out my union with the thought that I'm doing it for, hopefully my kids will have a chance at this job someday, and I want to leave it, you know, better than how we came in. And I don't think it's not really going too well right now, but hopefully more people come along like Mike and all these gentlemen and ladies and all you people and make some changes. So that's all I want to say.
San Diego, for a day and a half, in their introductory remarks and comments about the State of the Union, almost nothing was said about the impending grain contracts. In other words, forget it. We've got it under control.
It was a really sleazy way it went by getting through the 199 members of my local. But to get this grain agreement to be anywhere close to what we have at EGT by the five or six other locals that are going to be involved in this would be some feat. So I think this is going to help it bring it to a head because that's really what needs to happen. There needs to be an outrage of what's going on and what the agenda is. And I think they're going to bite off more than chew. Enough people are going to get pissed off and things are going to change. So I'd rather take this fight on right now than leave it for my kid. He's 20 years old. He just started being a longshoreman. And I don't want to leave this mess for him. I want to take care of it now. So I think this will actually help bring it to a head. So, I'm waiting to see what happens, too. But I can tell you that the talk is really getting to a point where, you know, this is not, they're not just buffaloing everybody over what's going on. I mean, there's really some talk up and down the coast of, hey, this ain't working out no more. I mean, so I think there's some change coming pretty quick.
Yeah, it's estimated that about 95% of it was built by... And the building trades, they started pretty early. They were all over it, you know, a couple years before the construction broke ground. But mainly what they did was they went to a lot of meetings, port commissioner meetings, city, county, whoever they could get to listen to them, and that's what they did. They didn't put up a picket line, and I think at one point in time they came and talked to us about it, and they weren't really 100% ready to go on it, and I think we were going to be in negotiations, so they didn't want to make waves for us, and anyways, it just never.
The building commission, when this started, the construction trades, I'm pretty sure they came to us. We told them, if you guys put up a picket line, we'll back you. Because so many times people ask us, you know, say, well, hey, where were you when they were building it? You know, I mean, I remember when this whole conversation was going on, and we actually got an ILWU just retiree in on this port commissioner of, you know, three port commissioners came to our hall to tell us how great it was going to be that this thing was coming. We had just started hearing the fact that they were going to try not to use us, you know, and as he gives us some people clap and he goes to walk out the door, I stood up and said, hey, hold on a minute. You know, what's this thing we hear about them not using us? You know, and he says, well, that's between you guys. That ain't between us. Oh, shit. So I confronted him on it, and, you know, that's how it turned out to be. And, you know, when we voted on this contract, I said no, but I was the only one that was obviously listening. And so it's funny how things get pushed by people. They just don't, they aren't listening very well.
That's a very good question that you raised, and that was one of the things that I had prepared in my notes tonight as to why was it that EGT thought that it could challenge the ILWU and put non-ILWU workers in that facility. One of the things that we have learned here in the Bay Area is that when there is going to be a facility that is going to be constructed on port property, it's important that there is a labor community coalition to demand a project labor agreement where all of the work that's going to be done at that facility is going to be done by organized labor and the people who live in the community. I fault our leadership in not taking the bull by the horns, because had we been in, even though we don't do construction work, it is in our interest to ensure that that is a that facility is going to be built by union members. That would have put an end to operating engineers coming in there if we would have taken that step. There's a problem today in labor. One of the things that came up during the course of our convention was the idea that the ILWU should come out of the AFL-CIO. Suffice it to say that that was more of a ruse than it was an actual plan. Because when you come out of the AFL-CIO, you got to have a plan, okay? To make a long story short, it's this. It was proposed that there be a maritime alliance, okay, to ensure that ILWU and ILA workers did not have this jurisdiction infringed upon. But you don't need to get out of the AFL-CIO to do that. The problem with labor today is that we're like this and not like this. And we should have nipped that in the bud. That was a classic example of the ILWU leadership should have understood that. It is absolutely outrageous. Once AGT knew that they didn't have to hire organized labor on that facility, hey, this is a cakewalk. That was the wrong message. So that's one of the things that we should learn from this struggle.
You know, our founder was really big, Harry Bridges was real big on organizing workers and our fellow man. And I heard the conditions that they're up against, and it's an outrage. I mean, I can't see a closer somebody with us than the people that are bringing the containers in and out of the ports. I mean, I don't understand why we're not standing by a fellow worker. Union or not, I mean, you know, we got to come together. And so, I talked to him for a while about that, and that's what needs to happen. I mean, that's what we need to do. We talk about laws and stuff. You know, everything that would ever work for labor was taken to Washington, made illegal. You know, when we started this fight, we didn't wait for nothing. When the gloves came off and we knew it was on, we went out and we did stuff. We didn't care about the law. If we worry about the law, then we've already lost, because all laws are against us. It's like that gentleman up there said. So it's about action and solidarity. The more you have come together, well, the better chance you're not going to go to prison. You know, I mean, we went out, we stopped trains, we tore down fences. You know, we didn't wait for the law. I think that federal judge in Tacoma that had just signed a bunch of injunctions. And then there was a night that a bunch of American workers, I'm not sure who they were, but raided that facility and dumped that train and cut those lines And I think that federal judge said the next day that he felt like a paperweight. No, for all the paperwork that he had signed the day before, that we couldn't do anything. So we can do, when we stand together, we can do anything we have to. And we'll change the laws if we just stand together. You know, divided, we're going to fall. An injury to one is an injury to all.
Amen.
And I don't care who it is.
A whole union, you know, of 200 people that said that was a good coach. Not one of them. They all said it sucked. So, obviously, when the international's going around saying, oh, no, this is a victory, I'm not sure who they're trying to prove it to, you know. We're the ones working on it. We know how. So there's going to be change. It's only obvious. I mean, it has to happen. I don't know how it couldn't happen. I look at life guys in the country. I stand behind you, and I don't understand all the politics of all the organizations. I don't have to. I just go by what I think is right, what I feel is right, I fight for. I think there's good things brought up in just about what everybody says. There's some good stuff. So I think Occupy is awesome. I know Clarence is a big supporter of this thing, and I think it's big, making change. I don't know what role it would play in us these contracts. I think if we started over with leadership with these contracts, but you know, time will tell. It'll be hard to get by five or six locals with a lot more people than we have in ours to try to justify this is a great deal. I don't think that people are going to buy it. So it's going to come to a head when this Northwest Grain Agreement comes up. Was there anything else you needed?
Let the brother from Longview speak.
I've learned a lot of things a year or so, and one of the things is there's a fine line between militancy and democracy. We kind of learned that the hard way in our union in the last year. I personally, being younger and new in the union, I didn't want it so much as maybe Mike, you know, who've been around for a long time. So I kind of, you know, I did a lot of work and just kind of kept my mouth shut. And when we had our little vote, whatever you want to call it, I kept my mouth shut, and Mike was the only one to give power to the officer's contract and sign it. And I've kicked myself ever since. I'll never make that mistake again, ever, even coming up. And as far as Occupy is concerned, anytime people want to come out and stand on the picket line and help each other out, I don't see why that would be a problem, you know, even with the officers.
Very quickly, I think that people should not lose sight of the fact that we're dealing with people's lives here. Shoremen get paid good wages, but one of the rarest tendencies of this leadership is to try to divide the working class by saying that shoremen and we're special. No, we're not. I've seen what happens in a small community where they know the cops, everybody shoremen are, longshoremen are respected in the community, carry out the orders of the ruling class. Said time and time again on YouTube that longshoremen did not honor those community pickets, that would be an irreparable breach. To Occupy is not some entity, it's the community. That's what Occupy is. I don't care how much money you make. If you're a worker, you're a worker. When you make $1,000, what happens when you lose your job? You're, quote, middle class. You're a worker. Longshoremen are workers. Workers with conscience. And there's some very, very dangerous that can emerge when a union like the IL loses its way. That's what happened with this. When a does not have any class consciousness, a rocket scientist to understand the importance of that. Occupy in the community did things that WU longshore dock workers couldn't have done on their own. There would have been all kinds of injunctions. Matter of fact, have been in jail for what actually happened. To have the community. We don't want just for ILWU members. We want it for the community too. That's what makes the ILWU special. Leadership of this institution doesn't understand that. Betrays the very principles. We don't put above the working class unity. shoremen know what the contract says. We behave. It's not necessary for Bob to tell us the contract says we don't honor community picket lines. But if that's a legitimate picket line out there, we're not going to cross. And he knows what longshoremen follow certain protocols. He is actually engendering division in the world. And gets back to what this dude Winslow is. These are people who do not believe in working class. They're intellectuals who pimp off the working class. Come and interview me. Don't think that we're shut down by Occupy independently. I don't know what gates to go to. Organize a picket line. There were rank and filers. And some of those rank and filers are known. Did Winslow show up on November 2nd? Part of that historic march? Was he a part of? We call those people. How do we continue this relationship with Occupy? Let me tell you one thing. With the benefit of forums like this, we will be able to show this to the rank and file. Longshore, they might be influenced by that leadership. Once they have to work with that contract, it's not good for us. And they question, like the brother was just saying, and he's being honest, he kept his mouth shut. Intimidation going on. He can't intimidate Jack or Keylor. I'm still active. Because I am the rank and file union. I don't care how much they talk about the general. Ain't no damn general. But one thing is, this is my own opinion. I could be wrong. But with all the missteps that leadership made, I kind of think he'd be very disappointed that he's getting another trial. Something to hang his hat on. Because the whole world watched. And it did not take a rocket science out. When EGT presented his proposal, all he had to say is, I got to get back to my. And when they say, what does that mean? Does that mean I use the community too? He had that in his hands, brothers and sisters and comrades. Use it. I'm through.
Just one sentence. The EGC contract will be demanded by all the grain heads in the Northwest when those contracts come up in September. I don't think the rank and file of those local Northwest accept that. I think you are going to see money. I would bet that there's going to be a major strike in the negotiations come this fall.
If you're going to learn anything from the Longview struggle, you have to learn where the defining moment was, where the union bureaucracy took over the struggle from the Longview rank and file. And that was at the January 6th meeting that Eric pointed out in Seattle. Okay, because the night before, Dan Kaufman, the president of the local, spoke in Portland. The international officers heard about it, and they withdrew the pickets from the picket line of all the other locals. That should be a signal to everybody what's happening here. On January 6th, the union bureaucrats organized an attack and tried to disrupt the meeting. Mike was speaking at, Clarence was speaking at, I was, and a number of other ILWU brothers. This was an attack by the bureaucracy against the rank and file militant that were trying to win this strike through class struggle tactics. And the shame is not just on Cal Winslow, but on the left. Somebody mentioned the International Socialist Organization that defended the union bureaucracy, but it wasn't just them. Here's the critical thing. In this letter, that the reason the bureaucrats disrupted the meeting, they said, you've got to read President Miguel Rath's letter. In a nutshell, I'll tell you, it refers to the Taft-Hartley and all the laws that we can't break, and it concludes with, a call for a protest of EGT is not a call for a shutdown of West Coast ports and must not result in one. That's what this letter was about, that the bureaucrats broke up the meeting for this letter. Besides the ISO, there was the Socialist Workers' Party, there was the Spartacist League, there was Socialist Field, a number of left groups blocked with the bureaucracy against the rank and file, against the class struggle program. This is a shame.